Hi, everyone, and welcome back to Tech Exception. Today, we have an exceptional conversation with a very special person, and we're going to talk about how his company is disrupting the autonomous driving world. So we have Alex Kendall, CEO of Wayve, with us today. Hi, Alex.
Hi, Eddie. It's great to be here.
Fantastic to have you. So Alex, how did you, came to the idea and said, hey, I wanna do something new in the autonomous driving space?
Look, I think it's all about building excitement around building embodied intelligence. Robotics has been an interesting space where for a long time, people have been building robots that we hand design how they behave and we really program what they should do and what they shouldn't do. But I think we've reached the limits of this technology. And what we're excited to be building at Wayve is how we can really expand this using machine learning, how we can build robots that can learn to do things more complex than we could previously imagine, such as autonomous driving, with the power of data and machine learning.
So were you working in that space before you started Wayve?
I was. I was doing a PhD at the University of Cambridge, researching computer vision robotics. I was really lucky enough to be doing this at the time when deep learning started to take the computer vision world by storm. We'd just seen the first models such as AlexNet that were able to do image recognition over large data sets like ImageNet. And they were starting to be transferred to more wider vision tasks. So I took deep learning from image recognition and showed that it could work in scene understanding, semantic segmentation, really understanding where you are, what's around you purely from a camera. And I think it's that kind of technology that gave us the confidence that we could take a system that could understand what it sees to be able to then make decisions and actually drive and act within the world.
That's really cool. So if I'm putting it back into context, you said, hey, I'm excited about this technology. I'm excited about working in the software area, and I'm going to continue to a PhD. And then the PhD kind of like rattled your world, and you said, oh, this is a great challenge that no one targets yet, and we can help improve the technology in this area, right?
Absolutely. I think the PhD was a special time of reflection, of thinking deeply about an area and also looking to connect a bunch of different dots from different fields, whether it's robotics, deep learning, and some of the various subfields within these topics. And it was that kind of introspection and connecting things and just getting going and building stuff without a preset commercial agenda that I think really led to it was the formation of these ideas.
Yeah, that's interesting. So can you, building on that, can you take me back to that moment that during your PhD, you were writing articles, working extensively in that field, reading a lot of materials, and kind of looking also on different companies and what people are doing in this industry. So take me back to that moment when you realize, hey, I have something, I'm working on cutting edge technology, and I can actually turn it into a successful business.
There are a few key signals. Let me walk through some of them. So the first one was, I think, when we were able to put together a system that can understand in one deep learning model the semantics, motion, and geometry of a scene that really gives you all of the scene understanding you need as a robot or a human to be able to drive and make decisions. To run that in real time and demo it live on a vehicle, I think, was the first key insight and milestone in my mind. The next one was, if you think back to 2016, 2017, this was the time when we started to see some early deployment of self-driving. In particular, Google Waymo went to Arizona and started servicing customers there. And I think this gave us a lot of confidence this technology now is the right time. But over the next few years, we just saw a challenge for this technology to scale with that current paradigm. It was one that was very capital intensive to develop, and one that inherently wasn't didn't have the intelligence that we'd come to see in some of the advances in machine learning. Because then think about that 2017-2018 period, where we also saw massive advantages in advances in policy learning agents, things like AlphaGo from Google DeepMind, or some of the video game agents in StarCraft or Dota that we've seen come out of the deep learning community. And the ability for us to learn these very complex game environments and learn to be superhuman at them with machine learning, I think there was a real understanding of a real thought on my behalf is, why can't we take these to real life embodied robots? Why can't we take them out of simulation and put them in the hands of society? And so I think it was scene understanding, looking at what's happening in the self-driving industry, and then these massive breakthroughs in machine learning through that period that led to saying, look, we can put this on a real life robot. There are massive challenges to do so about making it more data efficient and safe. That is, quite frankly, a paradigm shift from operating this technology in simulation. But that's what we've, that's what we've really set out in earnest to go and resolve.
I really like how you, you know, how you took specific technology and say, hey, that works well for robots, that works well for gaming in that space. Why not, you know, just bring it back to autonomous driving and autonomous vehicles and just connect all the dots and bring this awesomeness technology that we have and use it there. I really like that approach because it connects well to different things we do in Microsoft as well, because we have tons of technology, tons of services, and we always try to enable people to do more stuff on our platforms by basically giving the generified version of the things that we work with. And we can see it pretty widely on the different services that we have in the cloud as well. But we try to kind of give platforms for people to take the technology and use it in different areas and different domains. So I'm a big believer in that. If you see something works in one area, it might work as well. As I know, if we talk about autonomous driving, there's also drones and a lot of other autonomous systems that can be interested. So when I'm looking at Wayve, what is the biggest challenge that you're solving today?
Oh man, there's a plethora of challenges, and I think they come very unexpectedly. But if I could talk about the biggest technical challenge that we face, I think it is really building the robustness in these models. Because if you think about the problem that we're setting out to solve, we have a very high dimensional input space. If you think about the driving intelligence, the model that we are building is one that can understand the sensory input to a car and then make driving decisions. So like a human would, humans have their vision, they have their vestibular sensors and tactile sensors on the touch sensing on the actual actuation controls, and then they control the speed and steering and some other buttons within the vehicle. In a similar way, our deep learning system is taking, in our case, 6 or 7 cameras around the vehicle of about 1 megapixel of resolution. So that's already 6 million input pixels. Then you extend that to time, so not just space but time, and you also have other signals like the inertial measurement, the GPS, the navigation, and so all of these signals, the sat nav and the vision input to the model, of millions of dimensions, need to just be distilled down to a very few dimensions that control the speed and steering. You know, the limit is just those two numbers, speed and steering. And so this model that we need to learn needs to be very robust, because you can imagine the weird and wonderful scenarios that you get on the road. I'm sure you've all seen very bizarre things that occur in the very long tail of the distribution, and those are the ones we need to address. And so how to do this in a way where we can learn concepts that generalize, and we don't just say, okay, we've learned how to drive through this specific traffic light, but we've learned the understanding that, you know, a red light means that we should stop the vehicle, a green light means that we should go in some circumstances, and we can apply this in general, like as humans do when we go to new scenarios. How can we understand driving as a concept? It's that model that that forms a core challenge of what we're doing. And it's a very challenging statistical and reasoning adventure for us to embark on. In fact, one that is so hard to hand design as a human. And I think that model from the 6 million input dimensions down to the 2s and out is output is really one that machine learning is exceptional at, and something that we're leveraging.
Wow, so many challenges that you have in it. It's like the first thing is collecting this huge, huge amount of data, because like you mentioned, you have multiple sensors and you're collecting around 6 million pixels. If I was, is that per second?
That's 6 million pixels per frame, and we run it about
per frame.
30 frames a second. So multiply that by 30 to get per second.
And here you go. We got a huge amount of data that you're collecting, and then you need to filter it out, sift it out, remove the noise, understand what's relevant in that space, and also plug it back and create, train different machine learning models, and also deploy the different machine learning models on multiple units. So it's like, you know, you took all the challenges we have in software development and said, hey, you know, we'll do that and we'll make it awesome. So let's go back to the data part where you're collecting all the data. What do you do now? Do you like collect it on the cars themselves, or do you ship it somewhere to the cloud?
Yeah, our vision is really to build a driving school for robots where we have a huge fleet of connected vehicles that ship data back to Azure's cloud that we allow this, that we can use to actually train these models. It's a paradigm shift away from what you traditionally see in robotics, where you have a lot of compute on the edge, a lot of processing power on the robot itself to be able to run a lot of data processing and the like. But we want to have a very lean set of compute on the robot at the edge that can run very efficiently a deep learning model at inference time. But we want to be able to take this data back to the cloud and do very large scale training over it. And this training will develop a model that can understand the complexities of driving like I described earlier. And so we really do view it like a driving school in the regard that we want to get data that is on the boundary of knowledge for our system. So not ones that's too easy, like basic lane following that we just see so many examples of that we want to ignore, and not ones that are too difficult, like a very complex 5-point turning maneuver that might just confuse our system. And so we want to find it on the boundary of knowledge that we can extract those driving examples. And in particular, it's like if you go out for a driving lesson, you know, your instructor will put you in a scenario where you will learn from it and it'll be challenging for you. And we want to create the same environment for our vehicles through this distributed connected vehicle driving school.
So driving school for robotics, is that it?
Absolutely.
I like it. I really like that concept. It's super cool. Right, so you mentioned basically, well, you're building a school for robots to train everyone to know how to drive on the roads and train robots to drive on the roads. I really like it. And you also touched on the area that you work closely with Azure and Microsoft technologies. Are there specific technologies that you currently work with?
Yeah, it's across the stack. I mean, you can imagine deploying this connected fleet of vehicles and being able to ingest cloud data at scale to the cloud is very much one that aligns well with the IoT, the Internet of Things services that Azure offers. So there's that. And then there's also, many other services around authentication and device management. But then within the cloud, it's all about large scale data serving and training. I mean, we need to be able to serve data at 400 gigabits a second to compute nodes that can run very massively scaled parallel processing for deep learning. And so some of these technologies, whether they're the NVIDIA PLV100 GPUs or whether it's technologies like GraphCore and IPUs, I mean, it's getting as much data as we can to that parallel processing to run distributed training at scale. That's very much the world that we're in that Azure can offer on the training side.
Yeah, it's a massive scale. We see different levels of scale, and I think what you're doing is actually, you know, challenging everything that I personally saw in the area of how to do machine learning at scale. And it's exciting to see how you're building your product and how you're going to make us, you know, all of our lives basically easier and push forward what we do with the technology for autonomous driving. All right, so what, you know, what last question, what the future holds for Wayve?
What does the future hold? Well, what I think we're going to see is that this technology is really going to allow self-driving to scale at a rate that we haven't, we haven't imagined before. What I mean by that is that you can think about self-driving scaling on a number of axes. It's not going to be a technology that is initially everywhere. It's going to have a very initial limited deployment around a specific domain. In particular, you can imagine for example, a ride-hailing marketplace where ride-hailing might address a city. Self-driving won't be able to address all of those rides from day one. There might be ones that go through areas that are too complex or perhaps in weather conditions that are too challenging. And so there will need to be some interaction between the human marketplace and the ride-hailing marketplace. And the autonomous autonomous service within that marketplace. But the key thing is that we need to provide a positive feedback loop that grows the amount of autonomous services within that marketplace very quickly. And that not only within that marketplace, but other marketplaces. And so there's very much a domain adaption problem about how do we go from, let's say, ride-hailing A to ride-hailing B, or some delivery service A to public transport within different types of mobility within a city. And then there's also different domain adaption to different scenarios and weathers, and then ultimately to different geographies. So everything is about adapting the domain. And then when you not only consider that domain adaption to these different services, but also domain adaption to the shifting demands of society over time, as road networks change, as we get pandemics, as we get things that disrupt urban mobility, everything is about shifting data. And so we need a technology that can very rapidly understand and adapt to these changing demands and driving domains. Now, this is what machine learning can do. It's demonstrated this in many other fields, whether it's natural language processing or whether it's image recognition. I think the domain adaption of using pre-trained models and being able to very quickly adapt to new tasks with what's called few-shot learning, I think this has been very, very aptly shown from deep learning. Now, this is something that we can do in driving as well. And what this will mean is that we'll have a self-driving solution that can scale to society's needs. It's not just going to be in a small affluent area, but it's really going to grow in a way that lets us deploy it over hundreds of cities. I think this is the future that we really envision for mobility, and what we'll be able to bring transport for people down to low latency, sustainable, and and very efficient practices.
That's incredible. I'm looking forward to interact more actively with your products and everything that you build in Wayve. Alex, thank you so much for being with us here today and sharing your vast knowledge and expertise. It was indeed an exceptional conversation. So thank you.
A pleasure. Keep an eye out, and I think you'll all be riding in autonomous mobility in the years to come very shortly.
Looking forward. I'll stay tuned.